ever get the feeling that you're drowning? You can't tell up from down, left from right. You are sinking, and you're trying to swim and get the strongest stride and get your bearings, but you just can't seem to arrive. You just can't seem to get to the place that you want to be. And the further that it is that you stride, the more that you realize you are lower than you thought. And I'm not speaking about swimming or drowning per se. I'm talking about being in debt. And yes, if you are a student or previously were a student, then it is likely that you took some type of loan to get into school, and you are likely facing debt. And oh, such a restriction and problem debt can be, but can also be an effective tool for yourself. So we have to figure out how we can use debt and also how we can get out of debt. Hello, welcome to the channel. My name is Daniel. I'm so glad that you're here. Please ring the notification bell to be notified of any video that I upload. Please like the video, and I'd also like to ask you to subscribe. Now, I'm not a proponent of all debt being bad and evil, as some people may believe, but I will agree that having debt over your head is not a pleasant feeling. Now, if you know what you're doing with your debt and you have a plan as to how to use it and to pay it off, then debt could be a very valuable tool, especially if it's good debt as opposed to predatory debt. Now, whether student loans themselves are good or not, it's debatable. There are some good aspects of student loan and ways that student loans can be used. And there's also some things that were put in place because people abuse the system. And now student loans are, well, you're kind of signing your life away in some ways. But I would love to hear from you guys from the comments if you have any thoughts about student loans as a whole, whether something that should be recommended or not. But yeah, there's a lot to know and a lot to be concerned about with student loans as we consider what they are now. A student loan is the one debt that you can't declare bankruptcy on, and although that's technically not true, you actually still can declare bankruptcy on student loans in my country, at least, but under very, very specific circumstances. Not the same circumstances that you would have if you were, let's say, a business owner or something else and you wanted to declare bankruptcy. But more important than that is just learning the concept of it and using of using and borrowing money to attain education to actually help you prepare for yourself better and life. You really just want to make sure you're using your debt well, because for the majority of people, there's going to be some things that you need to attain, and you won't be able to attain it without taking some sort of loan in your life. So we want to make sure that we are taking our loans wisely and also paying off our debts as well, and thus being good stewards that we can use our money to better love the people in our lives and to handle the responsibilities that we have for flourishing and for a good life. Now, I always wanted to go to post-secondary school. I knew this growing up in school all the time, and I specifically wanted to go to university. Some options could have been far more expensive and others would have been cheaper, but I settled with a university that was roughly average in terms of expenditure, just for tuition alone. But I actually ended up saving some money because the university was actually pretty close to my house. And so going over, 45 minutes on the bus or 50 minutes on the bus to get to university wasn't too bad when I considered the years after my first year. In my first year, I knew that I wanted to live on campus, right? That first year experience, but more so the first year connections that you can make and just getting a good foothold in really learning what it's like to be a student in university, because it drastically changes depending on the high school you've been to and what you've been prepared for, even academically. So I knew that living on campus would come with heavy expenses, right? Some campuses have some sort of system where you pre-purchase an amount of money that you can use to buy food maybe on campus or some places off of campus. So we had a meal plan as well. That has some expenses. Of course, living on residence is its own expense. And it isn't quite cheap. It's quite a heavy expenditure. I'm so thankful my parents were able to support me heavily in my educational journey and endeavors, but I still need to take loans. In fact, the student loans offered at that time weren't actually enough to cover tuition. And so we had another way of kind of covering costs for tuition, but then also giving money to use and spend with for textbooks and food and everything else that I would need during those semesters that I would study. The situation would change as I ended up moving off of campus after my first year and started to rent. So I got a couple of buddies, people I met, people I did my courses with, and tried to figure out if we could live together and find a place to rent. Throughout my bachelor's, finishing my undergrad, eventually I took loans throughout all my undergrad and then later on for my master's degree. So your boy graduated at the end of April, ended up finishing my master's of public health, but that came with expenses as well. A lot. In some ways, it was actually more expensive than my undergrad simply because I wasn't actually able to loan as much or qualify for as many grants as I did with my undergrad, at least for some of those early years, until OSAP really changed, at least in my province, or at least in Ontario. Now, since there were some changes into how loaning worked, I knew that when I was entering to my master's, a lot more of the percentage of money that I received from the government would be loans as opposed to grants. And I knew that this would heavily rack up the amount of student loans that I would accrue. I knew it would hurt so much when I finally had to begin a payment and figuring out what I was going to do after I graduated. And this definitely came into fruition when that repayment date became closer and closer and closer. Now, in Canada, you actually have a six-month period that you don't have to repay your loans, so that new graduates, is meant to be used, so that new graduates are able to decide whether they're going to continue schooling and maybe further take on some loans, or whether they're going to kind of stop payments altogether, or maybe hopefully find a job and begin repayment. So to take advantage of this, what do most students do? Well, unfortunately, a lot of students just go on vacation, right? They go, they travel, they live life, they kind of live their life in their 20s that they feel like they've been robbed out of from doing school for so long, and they want to reward themselves, of course, for all the hard work that they've done in their studies. And, you know, they make travel logs. Do people still make vlogs? Is that still a thing? I should Google that. But essentially, yeah, I guess we still do do vlogs. But essentially, it's taken as both a break and as an opportunity to spend the money like it's yours. But the underlying truth is that during the six-month payment, which we call a grace period, where you don't have to pay your loans, interest still accrues. Right? So while you have a bit of breather room, let's say, the pressure builds up discreetly, and likely your expenses have only increased since you graduate because you feel a little bit free. You feel that you want to reward yourself for all the hard work that you've done, and you spend money frivolously over this grace period. Now, the pandemic has hurt everyone across the board as there are inflation concerns, considering just that we've printed, I believe, more money than have we printed before just within these 2 years of the pandemic. And of course, with low interest rates, a lot of people have been spending and lending a lot more than they probably would have otherwise, until they kind of had to reel it in and really get these inflationary measures under control. And so during the pandemic, there were tons of assists that the government has pushed out during this time to really support people financially, especially with student loans. And one way that they have is by actually putting a stop on interest loans, or rather on interest on loans. So if you were to log into your accounts on, let's say, National Student Loan Service Center, you would go in and you would see your remaining balance, and you'll see the interest that is related to your balance, and you will see whether that interest is actually halted, whether it's at 0%, or whether it's matching prime rate plus some. And so actually what this means for us is that, grace period or not, interest is actually halted. So for some of you, you don't need to make payments, and you also don't need to pay interest, or you know your interest is not accumulating. So this is actually a really good opportunity to go on vacation again. No, I'm just kidding. This is actually an opportunity for you, rather than to just spend your money as if it's yours, while knowing that you actually have a debt to repay money that wasn't yours. You can actually use this to drastically attack your loans and to pay down and reduce your principal, if not maybe even completely eliminate your principal. You don't have to actually wait until your repayment period begins to start to pay. And so you can proactively approach your debt to better free yourself up for your finances, effectively not celebrating the way you probably would have liked to celebrate in this time, but at the same time, you're actually preparing yourself better for the future, which is what I would highly recommend, which is what I've been putting into practice in my own life. There is a caveat, however. I mentioned that kind of student loans before put a pause on interest rates, but they actually put a pause on federal interest rates. That means your provincial interest rates are still going on. They're still going up as the interest rates from the Bank of Canada go up as well. And so I'd highly recommend you actually looking at that, the entire landing page, looking at your proportion of loan that's attributed to your federal loan if you're in Canada and your provincial loan as well, because they will have different interest rates. And at least until March 31st, I believe 2023, federal interest loans will be, or federal loans will have the interest halted, but that's not the case for your provincial loans. So actually, there's a bit of a story there, but I actually went and paid off my provincial loans directly, but there was quite a hassle to doing that. So we want to be careful. We want to really make sure that we're handling our debt. We're making a plan to follow through to pay it off, and we're being cautious of our interest, especially if you're in a grace-free period, whether this is a time where there isn't a freezing of interest rates or there is a period of freezing of interest rates. When our good friend Tiff Macklem raises rates, we know that it's going to affect us all across the board as Bank of Canada rates increase. So with that being said, how am I going to pay off my loans, and how can that help you pay off your loans if you're paying student loans? Well, I mentioned I've been paying off my loans aggressively since graduation, and depending on the month, I usually pay off about 62.5 to 65% of my income goes directly to my student loans. So I'm really cutting it close. I'm really taking as much as I can and putting that towards debt because I want it gone immediately. The goal is that originally my goal was, I believe I said I graduated at the end of April. My goal was to have my loans all paid off by that end date, March 31st of 2023, when interest rates will resume federally. For most people, the majority of your loan actually will be federal and only a small portion will be provincial. But when you go to pay your loans, you'll notice that a majority of your loans will go to actually the federal portion and only a minor amount will go to your provincial portion. In my case, when I calculated, every time I made a payment, 2.5% went to my provincial loan, which unfortunately still has an interest rate that's growing, and the rest went to my federal loan, which thankfully the loan is frozen, but otherwise this would be the larger portion. So it seems that this is maybe a mechanism in the system to really attack the largest loan, whether the rates are the same or not. But in this time where loans are, or federal interest rates are frozen, it really isn't, it hasn't been helping. And I tried to figure out every single way to pay it off, but essentially you can pay off your provincial loan first, and it's typically easier to do so by actually sending in a check or a bank draft for that specific amount, and also writing a letter of intent and mailing it directly to the National Student Loan Service Center. So that was a hassle, and that gave me charges that I did not want to deal with, but it meant that I got saved from at least couple of dollars, maybe $13. I can't remember the exact amount. If I know, I'll probably put it here. But it saved me some money from interest and potential interest, because you actually would never pay off that provincial loan until you pay that last payment of your entire plan. And right now, there's also talks about interest rates being frozen indefinitely in Canada. I'm not really banking on that, but if that's the case, then this could definitely change the way that you change your finances and how you pay off your loans. And I'm not sure if that would cover just federal loans or also provincial loans. So that's definitely something we could, I could talk about in another video. But by all means, you want to attack your loan aggressively. This is what I've been doing. This is probably the best thing that you can do, so that once interest kicks in, if you're unable to fully pay off your loans by then, is that you have a smaller principal, which means even if the interest rate is the same, you're not going to be paying as much in interest in general, just because you've done all that work on the principal. It's a really good time to attack that principal. So make use of it, please. I think at the time of writing this script, I had about 61% of my loans remaining. I'm happy to say that at this point, I'm actually at about 50% or a little less than 50% of my remaining loan. And I hope to still finish in this new year, in this upcoming year. But I may not finish by that March 31st date. There's actually been some hiccups with work and contracts and some other situations, which I can't dive into directly. But what I can say is that the expected amount that I was making each month changed, and that affected my planning and my saving, and then I kind of had to reorganize all my finances. So unfortunately, I'm not on the track to finish by March 31st, 2023, but I am still on track to finish a few months after, hopefully. And I'm so excited to just pay off that debt. And honestly, paying off debt, it kind of gets addictive. Like, it feels good to see that number be whittled down month after month. When I think about the pain of paying off student loans, and yes, there's a lot that you have to give up, but truly discipline forms freedom. You think you're restricting yourself, but you actually open yourself up to so much more. And so I'd really recommend that you discipline yourself well with finances, because it helps you all the more. It gives you freedom, financial freedom for your future. It doesn't matter how much you make. Yes, there are certain situations that may make things harder or easier, but if you're able to discipline yourself with what you have, you're able to make your own plan that you can follow to give you financial freedom. So I'd 100% recommend that you attack and approach your debts in this way. Really figure out, hey, how much am I making? How much debt do I have? What are interest rates like? Do I expect the Bank of Canada to increase interest rates in the next couple of months, this year, etc.? What benefits are there? Do I need to adjust my repayment plan? And can I afford to start paying off loans before my repayment period, right? You don't have to be super aggressive in paying off in a year, but I still would recommend definitely not going with just the minimum payment. Unless if, and this is a big if, but unless if you know that interest rates are completely stopped on your loan indefinitely, and you would rather take that difference of money and you would rather invest it and pay the minimum amount so that you can do a lump sum payment later. But I'd really recommend not doing that unless the opportunity avails itself. But for most people, there will still be interest rates, and you will be better off just paying down that principal as soon as possible. So if you take advantage of these, you are likely to just pay off your debt faster, well. Hopefully you keep that motivation, but more so than motivation, we want to build habits, we want to establish discipline, and just follow through, because consistency will give you results, and you will thank yourself later, I'm sure of it, for doing this. Now, enough about me. How are you currently paying off your student loans, if you are paying off student loans? And if you aren't, has this video changed your mind? Will you instead try to pay off student loans, or will you keep kicking it down the road and later let that snowball effect give you an avalanche later? So tell me, how do you plan to go about it? Comment down below if you have other plans or other ways, if you're considering how much of your income you're associating to, or how much of your income you're putting towards your debt. Please let me know. And if you've already paid off your loan and you followed another plan and it worked, I would also love to hear about your stories of just becoming a little bit more financially free, and especially becoming debt free, which is super essential in our day and age. Now, if you want to learn how I save my money when I spend so that I'm able to pay off debt, then you want to click this next video so that you can learn how I spend money wisely following 7 purchasing principles that I take whether I'm buying a small purchase or a large purchase. See ya.